Yes, we are back with two gameplays in one video. This is gonna be something quite boring because I have unlocked the Panther A and I've unlocked the T-44 and they're both stock. And now if my brain serves me correctly, since the Orange Doom has everything spaded and I haven't played the Green Doom in over a year, I don't really know what stock tanks feel like. Like, legit, I don't know what to expect, so I know I have to play a bit more cautiously. And when it comes to stock vehicles, we're talking about vehicles that can't put their fires out and they can't take damage. That's basically what it is. Now, I did notice a few things. I noticed that damage to the turret ring now works similar to the way it did in arcade. I don't know if this is a recent change or if I'm just blind. So that there is a way for you to fix it, but it doesn't put the problem aside. It just sort of makes it a bit... It reduces the rate at which the turret turns. But if you take damage to your cannon breech, your cannon barrel, you have to either find a capture point or a giant cliff to just jump off of, because you are useless for that match. But I think what's more annoying than parts, for me, isn't even the fire prevention equipment. And I've said a couple of times, fire prevention equipment would make sense if it worked something like crew replenishment. So you unlock the modification, you have the fire prevention anyways, because it's part of the tank, but when you unlock the modification, you can then replenish your fire prevention equipment when you go into a capture point. So say you're driving towards a cap, you're set on fire twice, you get into the capture point, you can be set on fire twice again. And if you're sitting in the capture point, depending on how fast the replenishment would work, you could technically take infinite shots to your engine, which sometimes happens. Sometimes you get immobilized, you're in a Yak Tiger, only your ass is peeping up from around the corner, and people just keep, yeah, you get the point. There's one thing that for me is more annoying than that, and I think it's because I got used to playing on my main account, and that's that every tank looks the same. Every tank from every player in every match looks the same. That's because you can't unlock camouflages unless you get a certain amount of kills. And I'll tell you right now, the amount of kills required for a lot of these camouflages is after the point you've already spaded the tank. And most people don't even spade vehicles, let alone play after they've spaded them. There are certain vehicles you will do that in, certain premiums that you'll just play, but for the most tanks you don't bother. It would be nice to kind of have more camouflages, to have a little... sort of variety in the battlefield. You know, if you're paying that crew training cost and you're paying for the tank unlock, might as well just give us some Silver Lion camouflage that we can unlock. And here we go, the nightmare of playing a stock tank. Your cannon barrel gets destroyed. What do we do now? I don't know why, but I saw there was a repair feature, and I thought, gullibly as I am, I thought maybe this will, I don't know, fix the cannon barrel? I mean, that's what I assume it does. I assume that this 15-second repair is going to actually fix something. Yeah. What this repair thing does, it changes the cannon barrel icon in the bottom left from black to red. That's all it does. Yeah. Cue the suicide. honestly never thought these words would leave my mouth in context of War Thunder, but thank fuck for teammates. Unfortunately there, speaking of teammates, I screw over this Tiger H1 because I don't think he saw the IS-2. I saw him. I just didn't know where to shoot because it was behind a tree and a bush. So I used him as bait, considering that I have just played the bait for my team. Only figured it was going to be a fair trade. So only lost two crew members, got to be repaired, took a lot of tanking shots, and that's basically the it for the match. Because, I mean, during the time that I was spending there camping, all the enemies said, oh, never mind, there's a ZSU-37 hiding in the bushes. But yeah, me and the Puma are going to finish him off real quick. There he is, trying to hide behind a house, put a quick shot into him. The Puma finishes him off. That'll be a kill and an assist so far in the game. Pretty boring, you know, honestly pretty uneventful. Only way to make this more eventful would be to, do a little spawn pushing.
Orange, don't you actually mean spawn camping, good sir? It is, in fact, spawn camping what you're doing.
No, it's not. Spawn camping is for people who are too shit to go for the capture point or the objective and just decide that they're going to go for the wannabe easy kills. Spawn pushing is something that everybody with a sane brain is going to do because they don't want to wait for the match to be dragged on, because the longer you're sitting in the match, the lower your activity is and the less research points you will be getting, which means you're less efficient and then you'll be spending all your time with your fat, greasy, groveling fingers just jamming it on in the YouTube comment section of some random RP video the Guardian publishes, because you can clearly tell their developers don't play the game. It doesn't help anyone. Just do the bloody push. And so that's basically what I did here. Just drove the Panther straight over the open field. I mean, because is there really a difference? I can be shooting over an open field into their spawn, or I can drive into their spawn, maybe, you know, use the binoculars a bit less. Yeah, get myself one more kill, and then we exit to go play the T-44. And here she is, one of my favorite tanks to be in the saddle of. This is the T-44. Love it. Good cannon, good mobility, good rotation, good armor. Just it's a well all-rounded tank. And at a bat rating of 6.3, you get a nice lineup, you get favorable matchmaking. And I don't know how rare this particular map is, but I got the small Sinai. Now, I don't play enough at this point to be able to tell which maps are in rotation, but there are certain maps that I used to play on a lot, and I used to enjoy playing on a lot. Karelia, Kuban, Jungle. I think Jungle is the one map that I miss the most. It's one of my favorite maps in the game, and I just don't get enough of it. I don't get it at all, in fact, because I don't remember the last time I played on that thing. And I did play on this account low-tier tanks. There was no Jungle. I know it's not in top-tier rotation. It's not in mid-tier rotation. I just don't know if it's still in the game. I wonder if they didn't just forget about it, you know? Now, I see a lot of big maps, you know, since Fulda was added and Maginot Line was added. These maps are great if you like wasting time, because they're not good for research points. If you're a free-to-play player and you're playing a stock tank and you get a big map, bail out. There's no point. All you're doing is just driving. You're driving a slow tank and you have no guarantee that where you're going isn't going to have you blow your barrel off and then just sit there like I did in the last match. You know, there's a massive gap between what's realistical and historical and what people say, you know, tank combat looked like in real life, and what fun in a video game is supposed to be, because this is what War Thunder is. It's a video game. And because the grind is already pretty miserable, by being a person who wants to play on big maps, you have to realize you're making the grind more miserable for other players, especially those who don't have the funds, the money, or their mom's credit card to pay for their premium grind. So, back to the gameplay at hand. Just one thing, if you have recently played on Jungle, please let me know which battle rating it was, because I'll play 50 matches in reserve tanks if that means getting one game on that map, because I miss playing on Jungle. So what we've done here is I've taken a sort of thought process. Because I'm stock, being in a capture point is a bit of a benefit. Even if I do get hit, I do get damaged, I can repair. I do also get a huge amount of bonus, and because I know there's going to be tanks camping along the ridgeline, this is a pretty good spot to be in. So first target is a Panther A, he was pushing forward. And because we're behind a house, we have a good lookout point. And they get shot by a Yacht Panther. Now, Yacht Panther is another 6.3 tank, which I really, really like. I love playing the Yacht Panther. Probably one of the tanks I'll try to research when I get around to my German 6.3. Now, obviously, I've gone with the safe route. I shoot him in the barrel. That's going to give me about, say, 20 to 30 seconds of sort of freedom. And I notice this rock here is also pretty perfect for extending the protection that I have from the house. So I have a lot of maneuver space in this particular, call it a campy spot, which is nice because the worst kind of camping spot or spots with protection is where there's not a lot of it, which means you're limited to where you can turn. And one thing about the Yacht Panther is that it has no protection on its rear, on its sides. So all we have to do is drive around them, which means going down this open road, which is where I have to be careful because there's probably going to be a few tanks sitting there as well. I take a cheeky shot here, just thinking maybe in a million years the shot will go in a weird angle, but even if it doesn't pen, what it might do is it might force the Yacht Panther to be, you know, angling towards me, which means maybe he'll unangle against one of my teammates. It's always nice to sort of keep the enemy at bay. And then I'm still looking at this main corridor, the corridor from their spawn to our spawn, and there's only one tank, and it's a Sturmpanzer. So I give him a solid shot. I know his cannon reach is out, so he'll be repairing. I can forget about him for a bit. I was shocked because not a single German tank really went, except for the Panther that we shot first. No tank went to attack or defend this lead corridor. So the Panther now spots me. He knows that I'm coming this way, but there's a house in between. And I figured, I'm just going to sit here for a bit. He can't see me. There's no physical way. I mean, he could blind shoot through the building, but he can't be certain where I am. So I just sit here and I wait. The Sturmpanzer can't come out for another 15 seconds-ish. And then I see the Yacht Panther turn around to angle for the IS-2. He takes the IS-2 out, but in the process, he gives me his flat side. That's going to be a free kill. And again, the Sturmpanzer still hasn't pushed out. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to where the Yacht Panther was. Going to get some high ground, like Kenobi would say, and just re-engage the enemies. I'm figuring maybe if I get over this ridgeline, there'll be some enemies camping on that side. I just didn't quite understand where they... Ooh, that's a Tiger. I can see a turret. Ooh, let's go for the cupola. That's a pretty nasty shot. But you can do that. Again, I don't know what they're doing. German teams, you know, it's like a wolf pack. You should really play in a pack. You should be at bay. Always be at bay. Push across. Find the Sturmpanzer. Take him out. And that will have been the last thing that I did this game, because I had a simple decision here. Do I go over the ridge and try to find somebody on the flank? I look at the minimap. There's nothing left alive on the flank, so we're going to have to go and spawn push, because that's the only place where the enemy vehicles are still left alive. What I did notice, though, is that there's a bomber coming in. I probably could have shot at him, but yeah, whatever. It happens once in a while. You do get revenge bombed. And what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to take a moment to actually pause the minimap from the moment I was spawning in my ZSU-37. And this is something that has to be looked at and analyzed when it comes to defining spawn camping versus spawn pushing. Right now, our team has players across the map. We have the capture point. We have all the tickets left when the enemy team has just over half. You can all agree that it would take a miracle for the enemy team right now to be able to make a comeback. And so, at this point, it's only natural that the players are moving towards where the enemy is. I mean, when the Allies were conquering Berlin in 1945, they didn't just stop on the outskirts and say, yeah, we're not going to push in there, that's Hitler's spawn point. As such, spawn camping is a occurrence, whereas spawn pushing is the norm. And one more important thing that has to be talked about is the relation between maps and objectives and these two terms that we have. Because the more capture points we have, the less common spawn pushing will be, or at least at a later stage will it occur. And spawn camping, I believe, happens a lot more on these big, wide maps that we've been seeing a lot of, because there are more places, there are more gaps between the line of tanks in your team that a player can just drive through and nobody will notice them. On a very small map, you know, with tight gaps between players, it's very difficult for a vehicle to just drive past and be able to get behind your lines. As such, in general, smaller maps will have less spawn camping, more spawn pushing, there'll be more experience on average, there'll be more silver lions on average. you know, if you're playing a free-to-play account, like I mentioned before, if you're playing stock tanks, smaller maps are your friends. Matches go by quicker, and by that, it's quite simply done and deducted that it's going to be more experience on average. It's going to be more efficient. At the end of the day, though, I think it boils down to one simple fact, and that is that we all play video games from the same reason: to have fun. And to do this, you have to reduce the frustration from the play. You have to make the stock grind easier or remove it altogether. You have to make, in general, the grind a little bit faster. You got to give the players the ability to select which maps they want to play on. Do they want to be spawn camped or do they want to be spawn pushed? Leave it to the person to decide. That way, the frustration can only be of their own origin. And as such, I'm going to hopefully wrap this video up just under 20 minutes. And probably see you in about, say, 6 to 7 months' time. Hope you enjoyed. Catch you in the next one. Take care and safe flying.